Hello, in this presentation I would like to talk about MacLim's inspector, which is called Clouseau. So the agenda for the presentation is talk a little bit about the background, the design and requirements of Clouseau, but all in all mainly focus on a user's perspective, showing how to use and specialize in Clouseau. The presentation will conclude with a list of open problems and some ideas for future work. So getting started with the background. First of all, there are a few names that I should probably get out of the way. So first is CLIM, which is the abbreviation for the Common Lisp User Interface Manager, which is a specification like CL itself, but in CLIM's case it describes a set of protocols for building graphical interactive applications. So the protocols are concerned with, for example, two-dimensional geometry, with windows, with the contents of windows, with drawing, with user interaction, so events generated by input devices and so on. MacLim then is one implementation of the CLIM specification. To my knowledge, it is the only complete open source implementation. So there are others, but they are proprietary. And again, to the best of my knowledge, it is also the youngest and, if you excuse me saying this, the most modern implementation. And finally, the actual topic of this presentation is Clouseau, which is sometimes also called the inspector or the MacLim inspector or inspector Clouseau. This name refers to a CLIM-based graphical application that is encoded in the included in the MacLim codebase. And strictly speaking, the name now refers to two applications of this kind, because there was the original Clouseau and now there's a rewritten version. And maybe regarding the origin of the name, can see this image on the right hand side. That's apparently a detective or inspector from a TV show or movie. So that's that Inspector Clouseau is apparently the origin of the name. So, as is tradition, let me start by trying to define what an inspector is using the Wikipedia article. The closest one I could find is Inspector Window, but it's actually pretty close to what we mean when we say inspector. So it says there's a selected object and current attributes are displayed, and it's also possible to change the values of these attributes on the fly. So I guess they added on the fly to emphasize that the change can happen at any time, and in particular while some other kind of process is happening. And that's also true for our interpretation of inspector. Still, I would add that our inspector can interpret any value. In our context, that's any value in the Lisp system, not just some selected or selectable object. And our inspector should also be able to navigate to related values, such as parts of a composite object. When we can inspect any value, we should also get a little help from the inspector in the sense that it characterizes the object, assuming we don't already know what it is, for example by indicating its kind or type in some way. If we say inspector instead of inspector window, I would say it doesn't have to be graphical anymore. And we will actually see two examples of this. And I would also say that just tweaking parameters is not the full extent of the changes we would like to make using an inspector. We would also like to change the structure maybe, or do other maybe side affecting changes on inspected values. So in this part I will give a very brief history of inspectors related to Common Lisp. So possibly the oldest is the inspector found in Genera, which I never used, so this is just some image I found on the internet. But as you can see, it basically has all the things I talked about before. So you can see it's a window. It has inspected objects, for example here this list, and you can see parts of it. And then I assume by selecting these parts you get additional inspection compartments, like here for example this appears to be the generic function that is the first element of the list, and then the instance here that is the second element of this list. So you can kind of drill down into the parts of composite objects, and then for the instance this goes further by displaying instance slots and their values. There are also, I guess, here commands to modify objects, but as I said I never used this, but it's interesting to see how this presentation of an instance, for example, was already there in Genera. Then there's the CommonLisp inspect function, which I guess since its implementation defined is neither graphical nor textual by as mandated by the specification, but in the implementations I tried it's always text-based. Here's the SBCL built-in inspector. As you can see, it also presents the object type, parts of the object, and then allows navigating, for example, into the first element of the list, which is then displayed as an instance with slots and slots as slot values. The next example is the slime inspector, which is also mostly textual, and you probably all know this one very well, so I'm not going to say very much about this. Just note that in contrast to the Genera inspector, the slime inspector always displays one object, so in this case the port instance here, and then its components. But you cannot, for example, look at this port and then say this TrueType font family instance in detail at the same time. So selecting the other instance will navigate to that, and then you can't look at the parent object anymore. Also note that the slime inspector has operations depending on the object type, in this case set value and make unbound, to operate on the slots. Other examples are changing hash tables or modifying generic functions. Then pretty close to today's topic is the original inspector Clouseau, as previously contained in the MacLim codebase. I can also demonstrate this live. So this is the inspector window. Here you see a list with a single instance in it. Clicking the instance will expand it. Here's still the list containing the instance. And then we see the object class type, if you will, slots and slots, slot values, and this expansion works recursively. So for example, we can expand the screen within the other instance, and then maybe a symbol, and so on. So even the integer can be displayed in more detail. We can also collapse those again. And we can also try to find specialized operations, but as you can see, there aren't many in this case. Mainly expanding and collapsing objects. And because, as you can see, the ability to operate on objects is kind of limited, and it's also sometimes kind of hard to see which object is which without highlighting it. So for example, this is one instance, but if I look at it like this, it's harder to see. Yeah, and there are other limitations as well, but I won't go into detail about those right now. So, and finally, this is a screenshot of the rewritten inspector, which I will show in more detail later. But as you can see, it also has the typical ingredients. So here's a history of inspected objects at the top. Then you can see multiple inspected objects at once. And there are also specialized operations on the inspected object, as we will see in a bit. So, as I already alluded a little bit, the rewritten inspector is also the result of a redesign. And before a redesign, one should ideally start with requirements and goals. So this is a bit of a repetition, I guess, of things I already said, but I will go through this quickly. So we want to visualize values, of course, including composite and nested values, and looking at multiple values at once. We want to visualize relations between values, for example, containment. The inspector should indicate the kind or type of values. If an object, the same object now, or the same value occurs multiple times on the screen or in the inspected value, this should be handled and indicated in some way. Since we have in MacClim or in Clim in general graphical capabilities, the inspector should take full advantage of those. Then regarding the navigation between values, it should be possible to search for strings within the current object, current tree of inspected values. Maybe neither the old nor the new inspector Clouseau can do that at the moment, so that's a bit de-emphasized here. It should be possible, of course, to expand and focus on and visit values and parts of values. A history of visited values should be kept, and also the currently visible presentation should be updated if the value changes, or at least it should be possible to indicate that the value changed, and then the visible representation should be updated. And for manipulation of values, the inspector should offer suitable operations based on the value type, but also on it, based on the context in which the value occurs. For example, the slot in which a value is stored should also be taken into consideration. The slot could be, for example, read-only, or it could be writable, it could have a certain type, and so on. And all the highlighted parts were hard or even impossible to achieve with the previous architecture and design of the original Clouseau. So that's the reason for the redesign. And this is basically the key design decision, introducing first class places. Let me start with the terminology. It is obvious that place has a meaning in Common Lisp, and this first class place in Clouseau is very similar to a Common Lisp place, except that it is first class, so it is represented as its own object in the data model of the inspector. And the impact can be seen in the graphical representations. On the left, there's the old inspector. As you can see, it shows a value and then, for example, a slot name and a slot value, but the slot itself is not represented, and even more pronounced, for example, for a hash table or a list, there are just the values, just the list elements. In contrast, in the new rewritten inspector Clouseau, places are represented explicitly but also visualized as their own little thing. So all the highlighted elements here are places. For example, the top object here is an instance. There are slots in the instance. Then the places tie together the slot and its value. So the object with the red border is the value of this color table slot, and this arrow indicator here is the slot place. This is also true, for example, for the hash table, which has a number of places, and then a number of places for its parameters, if you will, and also for its keys and values. Now, some places are immutable, for example, the hash table parameters. At least some of them cannot be changed after creation of the hash table. They may change indirectly, for example, by adding entries or so, but it's not, they are not setfable, if you will. In contrast, and those are shown in orange in Clouseau. In contrast, the purple places are changeable. So, for example, changing this place would associate a new value instead of this one with the key gray 75. So that's basically the operation to change this place is basically setf get hash. And this is done consequently for all object types and place types in Clouseau. The practical consequences will be obvious in the demos that follow after this. So here's a slightly more detailed look at the new architecture. The overall architecture is model view controller, which is omitted here. So the inspector state is basically the whole model. And then we look at the model components below that. There is one root place, which has the inspected object at the top. So on the previous slide, this CLXTTF port instance was the root object, which is the contents of the root place. Generally, places have a container and a cell. So I think the easiest example is the case where the container is an array and the cell is an index, and places are also specialized according to the kind of container and cells. For example, the example I gave, the array element is actually a subclass of place, and then for rank 1 arrays there's also further specialized vector element place. And notably, the place does not store the value of the object, only a way to find the object. So looking at the certain index in the array is a way to find the value. But if the value changes, we will look up the new value. Then associated to the with the place are possibly child places. So for example, if the array element is itself a list, then the list can have elements. Those will be list element places, and they will be children of the, in this case, array element place. Furthermore, each place has an associated object state, which is the class of this. The concrete subclass of the inspected object state is based on the actual value. So for example, if an instance is stored in the array, then the object state will be an inspected instance. The object state is on the one hand responsible for memorizing the current way the object is displayed. For example, we have seen that objects can be expanded and collapsed, so this state is stored in the object state, but there are also more possibilities to change the display of an object, those are all stored in the object state and potentially in specialized subclasses. And finally, there's an associated style that handles the what I just said, so the collapsed, expanded, or displayed in different ways in general. And yeah, this is basically enough to display objects in specialized ways and also to offer specialized operations on values and places, as we will see in the demonstration. And this actually brings us to the demonstration. So I would like to start with some basics. So this is the new inspector closure. For now, it looks very similar to the old one, but as we do more, the differences will become obvious. So first of all, as I already said, the window layout. This is a history pane, a history list, which is currently empty because I didn't inspect multiple objects so far. And this is the typical interactor found in CLIM program applications where you can enter commands. So in this case, this is the list of commands I could enter. It is also possible for people who don't plan to use this to hide this pane and use the inspector pane in the middle exclusively. But for me, it is sometimes helpful to have this, and for this demonstration, it will be needed as well. So the I guess easiest interaction is expanding objects. So in this case, I expanded an instance and it shows the slots of the instance, in this case sorted by superclass from which the slot is inherited. So in this case, we can see the slot name, the place for the slot, and the slot value. And if we go further, we can see what we already saw in the screenshot, hash table values and keys, and those can be expanded further, of course. Same for strings, floating point numbers, and so on. Now, one problem with the previous inspector was, say, I'm interested in let's go further, maybe to this this is generated on the fly, so if the object is not stable, I can't inspect it further, but that should not be a problem. So let's say I want to look at this in detail, but I can't. In the previous implementation, I couldn't get rid of any of the surrounding stuff, so I had to maybe scroll to the right to see things and so on. That was annoying. So in this case, we can, instead of only like this expanding and collapsing, we can also say select this object. This is also bound to the middle mouse button by default, and what this will do is make the selected object the new root object that is currently being inspected. And this also activates the history list here, so I can go back to the previous inspected value, and I will see everything exactly as I left it, and I can then also go forward to the new object, and that will also be as I left it. So that's already an improvement, hopefully. And then the other command we already saw in this context menu is evaluate a form in this context. So I can select this, then I'm queried for a form. If I just say star, that evaluates to the object on which I executed the invoke the command. So in this case, the character G from here. And for convenience, there's also the root object. So if I say star and star star, I get the object and also the root object, which is this proper list thing here at the top. So that can be pretty nice to evaluate a little form here and there, maybe to further inspect things that are not shown, or to change things, or transport certain values into some other context within the common Lisp system. I don't know. I mean, evaluating forms can have basically infinite purposes. So those are the very basics. Now I would like to show some of the specialized value presentations. Let's see. I prepared something, if I can find it. Yeah, that's almost good. Okay. So this says I should start with multiple occurrences. So in this case, that's annoying. So in this case, I have two occurrences of this list right next to each other. So let me use another feature. As you can see, I take the place and drag and drop it to somewhere else, and then in this case, array elements are swapped. This works with all mutable places. And now this should work better. So you can see the identical objects are pointed out by the inspector. Also works when they are expanded. So okay. Also the class list appears multiple times, or even three times now. So this can be used to quickly see objects which are maybe printed identically, or in general circular structure. Then a few things for numbers. So as I said, the inspector generally tries to provide useful details. For example, for integers, we get the thousand separator, different bases. We count the number of one bits. We get prime factors for numbers which aren't too big. Then for floating point numbers, we kind of decompose them and show the individual components. For complex numbers, we do something similar, although the part type here is bogus, so that's a bug. This also tries to show the number in the complex plane in some way. Then for hash tables, we already saw this, but maybe this wasn't obvious. So this bar here shows the current count, then where the rehashing will happen, and the current size, and then also how big the table will be after rehashing, and of course the table of keys and values. Then classes are also inspectable, and as you can see, classes generally contain lots of information. We'll even make the window a bit bigger. So in this case, for example, here's a table of slots, or information extracted from the slots. So this can be useful sometimes to see this in a tabular manner, but then there's also the slot object itself if needed. Then maybe a nice thing is showing the lists as graphs. Well, in this case, the hierarchy is completely linear for both super and subclasses, so I should, yeah, maybe I can show this better later for another example. I could also, if the class wasn't already finalized, I could finalize it here. As you can see, there are other things, but I shouldn't linger too long here. Then the array. Yeah, I didn't mention this, but the top object here is an array. As you can see, it is adjustable. It has a fill pointer. And maybe you wondered why the color changes here. So the elements beyond the fill pointer are currently grayed out. So let me say increase this. So as you can see, the fill pointer is a mutable place, and incrementing it will change which objects are considered kind of inactive and which are active. So changing this is reflected in the display here. As you can see, this is also mutable, so I can use the new place value command, and let's say we make the place, we change the place value to 13, and in this case it adds adjusts the array and adds some default element while the fill pointer remains the same. For adjustable arrays, we can also, for example, remove the place itself. So the seventh element, we can say remove this, and then it will be gone, and the whole thing will be one element shorter. And as you can see, the fill pointer remains the same, so one of the following elements kind of filled the gap here. Finally, okay, we also have lists. Yeah, you probably have seen this already. So collapsed, they look like this, a simple A list and a simple B list. And then based on some heuristic, Clouseau detected that this is A list shaped and chose this as keys and values. Which can also be manipulated like this, for example, swapping things around or removing maybe. Oh well, that didn't work, but yeah, I don't know, must be a bug. But the other operators also work, as you can see. And this is the plist example, so that's looks the same in this presentation, but as I said, there are sometimes more than just expanded and collapsed. So in this case, we can say show as graph, and then this also show as graph, and then the difference is obvious. So in this case, there's a single kind of spine to the list where all values are in the car, and in this case, you can see the cells with a key and a value, and then the spine consists only of two elements. So that's also nice and sometimes interesting. And I forgot instances here. So here's a simple instance. The only interesting thing here is that the slot has the type Boolean, and Clouseau uses this to infer which operation can be done on this place. So if you look here, this always documents what clicking different buttons would do in this situation. So in this case, it says left mouse button to set the value to true, because it's currently nil, the only other value is true. If I click, it will toggle the value back and forth. So that's an example where the value and the context, so in this case, the place, have to be taken into account, as I mentioned during the description of the redesign. There's one more fun thing for instances. You can say change class, and then I say bar in this case, and I don't have bar. Oh, I see, yeah, because it's buzz, I think. And then, as you can see, slots are added and removed according to the change class, and then everything keeps working as expected. There is one more, or is it? I thought I wanted to talk about functions, but maybe it's in the specialized operations slide. Exactly. So for functions, we can also do interesting things, not so much with the default presentation, but with the operations. So in this case, we start by the symbol, then we see the package and the different slots, in this case the function slot. This is the named function equal, and it has operations. Well, I won't try to trace this one actually, but the second operation here, show disassembly, is also interesting, I think. Well, let me also show the trace. How to best do this? Maybe we can define a function here, which doesn't do anything, and then go back to our example. Put the function into the slot here, and then we can trace it. And as you can see, then it's marked as traced. Not super interesting, but I thought this was neat. Okay, so the second one here is show disassembly. Yeah, so this does what you would expect. There's a more fancy version which shows basic blocks as a graph, but that's basically experimental at this point. Okay, so I already did most of those. Yeah, I already did all of those actually. So we can just press on. So this is for updating. I will close this and go to Emacs, to this Emacs. Yeah, I hope this, oh no, not this one. I hope this will be visible on the stream. So what we do is, well, this is probably now, well, something is not right. Okay. Okay, so finally, this should be good. Let's quickly make a new inspector. I hope you can see all of this properly on the screen. So let's do this. The inspect function returns the expected object, but in this case I want the inspector itself. So I will do this. This gives us an inspector window and the inspector object in the variable here. And now let's see, we can now update the inspected object like this. And we have to say run hook so that the graphical display also updates. So as I don't know whether you could see this, but now we have these two values, and I switched from the first to the second. Okay, so to make this more interesting, let's say from 0 to 5 by this maybe, and then let's make a circle like this. While typing, while recording is much more difficult, I have to say. Okay, so this updates the inspector a few times, and then we should see the visualization like going in a circle in the complex plane. Yeah, and as you can see, this was kind of flickery and also updated this history thing way too much. So I will try to show a potential solution for that later. Yeah, but it is possible to update any displayed value programmatically and have the graphical presentation reflect that. So the next thing will be customization. By the way, sorry for the somehow my Emacs theme carried over into the slide, and I forgot to fix it. So the second one will be system dependencies. What now? ASDF, ASDF system Lisp, maybe no. Okay, so as I said earlier, there's a bunch of protocols that must be used. And in this case, what we need is inspect object using state. So the object will be an ASDF system. The state will be a Clouseau inspected instance. Then the style should be expanded body. So we want this to only apply when the object is expanded. And then our stream is usually a extended output stream. So let's start by testing whether everything works or not. So we just format, not there, but here, and then we call the next method. Okay, so and then we inspect a system. I think a good one was retrospective. I think, right, this has to be ASDF, find system. Okay, so there it is. And as you can see, this is the output we added. That's not very exciting, but we can extend this from here. So we say format graph from root. Our root will be the object itself. Then we must give away, we must specify a way to present graph nodes. For now, we can just print the object, and then we must specify a way to find children. Let's say node here, so we have both variables available, and this will be ASDF system depends on. This is all simplistic, of course. You would have to do more to make this actually work properly, but it should be good enough for this demo. And since the dependencies we get from here, they will be names, so we have to look up the systems. And those are the children, so that's fine. And then we have to say we want to use this stream, we want to merge duplicates. And to make this look better, I also say maximize generations. Okay, let's see. Okay, so we got a graph of systems. But now it would be nice, or at least it would show off Clouseau's capabilities, if we could expand those to, like, inspect them on the spot. And to do this, we say formatting place. The place we say will be in the current object, and it will be a pseudo place, so it's not an the dependencies are not actually places in this object. So we say it's a pseudo place. So in that way, we can just say this node thing is a part of this object, even though that's not the case in actual data structure sense. So this binds for us a present function, which we call on the stream, and then that should be it. So now, as you can see, the presented graph nodes are sensitive, and this one is another occurrence of the top node, which makes sense. We started from that system and then traverse the dependencies. And now the interesting thing is we can inspect each of those, we can expand them and see the slots and also their own graph, because they are of the same kind as the object we are currently inspecting. Yeah, so that's the quick demo of the user extensibility and customizability. There's a whole chapter in the CLUSO documentation which explains this in more detail. So that concludes the demonstrations, or at least the live demonstrations. So I think CLUSO is pretty nice, but it also has few shortcomings and disadvantages compared to Slime's inspector. So currently it is not usable without the mouse. That's because, as I demonstrated, you can type commands, for example, let's say evaluate in, no, I want, what's the one, evaluate in context, evaluate with context, I can type that, but then to select the object, I have to click, for example, this. And then the form, I can just type that again. But at the point where I had to select the presentation, I needed the mouse. So that's currently not ideal for a keyboard-based workflow. Then another major problem is there's currently no usable search, or even better, incremental search. So if I hit Control S, you can see, you can maybe briefly see it says something about iSearch, but it doesn't do anything. So this is like general McClim feature, but it doesn't work in the right way for McClim at the moment. Then there's no Emacs integration, which is a advantage of Slime's inspector. You can copy things between the REPL and the inspector, and the debugger is also integrated with the Slime inspector, and it's similar for CLUSO. It's integrated with the CLIM debugger and the CLIM listener, which are the REPL and debugger of the CLIM environment. But as long as there's no CLIM editor, this is not a proper replacement. Nevertheless, some of the disadvantages or current shortcomings may be addressed in the future. So for example, for selecting presentations, I made this prototype at some point. So here you can see an inspector and a prompt for an object. And in that case, it displayed numbers which could be used to select presentations. It's a bit broken, as you could see, and it's also not available in CLIM Master right now, but that's an idea for addressing this. Then there's a problem with a general problem in MacClim with flickering. So you probably already saw that in the when I updated the complex numbers, there was a lot of flickering. But we hope to address this by switching MacClim to double buffering. So, that's unfortunate. Let's see. I think it was MacClim. Wasn't it MacClim double buffering? Probably this one, yeah. So there you can see the same thing, but without the flickering. This concludes the presentation. Thank you for your attention. And currently on the screen are resources that may be helpful regarding CLIM, but also regarding CLUSO, the inspector. Thank you again for your attention, and that's the end of the presentation.